How's it going, guys, girls, others? Wanted to make a quick video on a topic and subject that I don't think gets talked about much, and probably with good reason, but it's an area that I've actually seen come to fruition strongly in two different areas of interest for me. Those areas are sport, through multiple different disciplines, endurance, strength, skill. Skill-based sports, all different categories, all with overlapping categories themselves. And then the trades, so tradesmen, tradeswomen, folks who are building stuff typically. So the concept is the concept of efficiency. And efficiency is a really interesting one definitionally. So within sport, it's actually really easy to think about efficiency with any sport that's highly repetitive. And most sports have very repetitive pieces to them. Endurance sports should be a no-brainer. Cycling, running, cross-country skiing, swimming. It's basically all repetition. There's almost no diversity of movement. So in the case of, let's say, cycling, which I have a special relationship to after racing at a pretty high level for like 4 or 5 years, much of the, let's say, the expertise or the skill comes from practice. Obviously, now what the practice does is not only change the body, let's say biologically, in the way we might normally think about sport performance improvement, blood volume, oxygenation, capillary size, a bunch of other technical things that I'm not prepared to talk about right now, but there's an area that doesn't get talked about a whole lot, and it's the idea of efficiency, which is to say that as you repeat movements over time with good practice and good proficiency, doing the movements simply gets easier. So it's one of the primary reasons why someone is capable of doing so much work or expending so much energy and moving so quickly on a bicycle or on foot or in the pool, is that they've actually, through practice, conditioned their bodies, their central nervous systems, their brains, quote unquote, trying to simplify, to move with the least amount of cost, if you will, to their bodies as possible. This is actually easy to understand when you're, let's say, learning a new skill. So think about something you're good at. Let's say it's playing the piano or knitting or dribbling a basketball or hiking. Think about taking on a new activity that is very different from the one you're currently proficient at, and think about how low your proficiency is. Think about how low your efficiency is when it comes to that activity. You can do it right now, actually. If you want, you can try to do a balancing pose, a yoga pose that you've never done before. You can just find one and try it out. You're going to probably suck at it at first. But what's interesting to see is that you're going to get a lot of benefit really quickly initially. Now, a lot of that initial benefit is actually efficiency benefit, in the sense that the more quickly you're going to adapt to a specific movement, and obviously the more complex the movement, the harder it'll be, whatever. But and there'll be some individual variances. So you might just suck at knitting, but you might be pretty good at learning ping pong. And why that is definitely too deep for this conversation. But the idea is you're going to realize a lot of benefit really quickly, simply through quick neural upgrades in efficiency. So that's pretty cool. Obviously, to get much better at anything is going to take a lot of time, but initial benefits are going to be quick and they're going to be pretty profound, especially if you're a neophyte to begin. Now, we see this exact same thing happening at, within the trades. It's one of the reasons that the trades are pretty specialized. As we get into more production, quote unquote production, let's say carpentry or drywall or painting, the more specialized a tradesperson gets, the more efficiency they're going to gain. And their efficiency gain, hopefully by now you're understanding why this might be, but their efficiency gain is largely going to be because they're practicing the same movements with tons of frequency and gaining tremendous amounts of efficiency moving through otherwise complex patterns. So a really fun thing to do is try doing drywall for the first time. Think about all the stages and steps you as an individual are going to need to take, assuming you've never done drywall before, to not only do all the learning required and then get all the tools required and then get all the setup required and to actually apply the drywall, you're going to be so inefficient and so low in your capacity to get that work done that it's going to feel like there's no way anyone can do that work at the speed that people can. and then pop onto YouTube and watch a professional drywall crew finish drywall, which is to say apply tape and mud in multiple smooth layers to an unfinished room. You'll be astounded at the capacity that these people have to do what to you seems like an impossible task. Now, again, the reason I brought this all up is not to say practice is all it is. It's the concept of efficiency. It's that, so me personally, I'm capable of doing drywall. I've done it. I'm relatively well set up to do it quickly, but I lack the level of efficiency that full-time drywallers possess by a huge margin. I mean, even if we set up and walk into the same room with all the same tools, all of the mud already mixed, the precision, the consistency, and the speed at which someone who drywalls every day and has been for 20 years is just going to make me look like I've just learned. It's just going to be embarrassing how different it is. And it's not because my body isn't physically capable of doing the work, but a lot of it comes down to, let's say, the specifics of the learned skill. So that's pretty cool to know. It's also the reason why, let's say, roofers or construction workers, guys who do a ton of heavy carrying and lifting every day, laborers, don't get super muscular. Largely, efficiency takes over and they actually get to the point where they can do that level of work relatively easily. If you, as someone who's not used to doing, let's say, day laborer type work or farming or very high labor, you're going to get absolutely crushed in a couple hours of the kind of work that people are capable of doing for 12 hours a day in the summer. Now, we can say that part of it is just genetic, part of it is epigenetic, and that's fair. All this is relevant, but the point stands. I don't think people tend to realize how these kinds of adaptations work and how long they take to become effective. But I also want to point out the fact that a lot of these adaptations, the early adaptations, happen relatively quickly. But they rely on a couple of different factors, and I think that's kind of the point of what I'm doing in this video, is to highlight the fact that we are entering a world in which the capacity to pick up and adapt skills is going to be held in higher and higher regard. I don't think specialists are going away in a lot of different fields, but I also don't think the kind of long-term consistency that people are going to expect in terms of how to, let's say, interact with technology or even interact with other humans in the social context is going to remain as stable as it has remained up until now. 1,000 years ago, the life of you, your father, your grandfather, your great-grandfather, your son, your grandson, your great-grandson would have all been almost identical, especially if you were living a more agrarian or a more hunter-gatherer lifestyle. There's no way that we can think 5 generations ahead now and say, yeah, we're probably just going to be farming or millers or laborers. That's almost impossible to think is going to happen. And I think actually a lot of the sort of existential angst that we're feeling is largely due to that. So knowing about efficiency and thinking about ways to increase and improve efficiency is actually really useful, especially because we realize that a lot of the initial benefit, let's say, in interacting with a new technology or understanding a new social media platform or figuring out a new way of taking your writing skills to the next level, generally speaking, are actually going to be relatively quickly. Again, efficiency gains are going to be relatively high, especially if you're using good techniques and good strategies. So this is one area of interest I think we're just going to continue seeing burgeoning. I think a lot of it right now comes in the form of what can be construed as, and I think somewhat correctly and somewhat incorrectly, as self-help or hacking. There's a couple of personalities out there who are well known for sort of hacking things, biohacking and neurohacking. And maybe the terminology is a little bit silly, but I'd rather remain open-minded and just kind of remember that there are huge efficiency gains to be had through very little input. And I think keeping this in mind is quite useful, especially because it seems that the more we learn to take advantage of these efficiency and these little learning moments, the better we get at breaking into new learning in the future. So, so it's worth thinking about. So just as you're learning a new technology, let's say you're learning a new social media platform or some new marketing techniques, be aware of that sort of initial feeling of resistance where you're overcoming let's say, the inertia of what you didn't know, overcoming your own sort of feelings of inadequacy, and begin to feel what it feels like to start to feel into that new efficiency, to really get a sense of what is coming forth and how exciting it is, as opposed to thinking about this sort of desire or need to learn a new thing as being a huge burden. Be aware of what it feels like to learn, be aware of what it feels like to build new efficiencies, and appreciate it. It's pretty awesome, and I don't think it's a skill we're gonna get away with not having, so yeah, hopefully that was helpful, and of course any comments are well appreciated. Take care.